Good evening, everyone. I want to thank the Cleveland Jewish News, which co-sponsors with us, and the Cleveland Jewish News Foundation. And we're really happy to have Bob Jacob here and Amanda Cohen also, who's a reporter from the Cleveland Jewish News. So while we're going to be discussing three topics, newsy topics this evening, I'd like to start with something to sort of ease us in. And what we're going to do this evening, like last week, is to do a field report, notes from the field. Last week, we had the Oberlin rabbi with us, who told us a little bit about what was going on Oberlin's campus. And this week, we have Kyla Schneider with us, who I should introduce. I'll introduce all of us, actually. I'm Alana Cooper. I direct Jewish Lifelong Learning for Case Western Reserve University. Brian Amkraut is our executive director of the Lifelong Learning Program. And Kyla Schneider is with us. She's a well-known teacher throughout our community. And in addition, she's here also as the principal, as the chair of Nakum, which is the Task Force on Dementia and Aging for the Cleveland Jewish Federation. And she is also the principal at Solel Coaching and Consulting. Kyla, we're so happy to have you with us.
I'm so happy.
Please welcome Kyla. Thank you.
Good to be around.
Thank you. I recently returned from a trip to Boston, and Kyla recently returned from a trip to New Mexico. And we got to talking, and in an interesting way, some of our reflections on our trips intersected. And I want to just bring you into that for a few minutes. I was in Boston at the annual conference of CAGEM. CAGEM is the Association of, what is the C for?
Consortium.
Consortium? Community?
Community.
Association of Jewish Museums. It's basically the Jewish museum professionals all across the country come together under this umbrella organization, and they have a conference once a year. And this year it was in Boston. It was actually my first time there. And one of the issues that came up was that there's actually no Jewish museum in Boston. And we ended up one of the days in the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, where they've recently acquired a nice-sized collection, most of it coming from the Schusterman family. And they had to figure out how to display their collection of Judaica. And the Judaica that they have is primarily ceremonial. They call them ceremonial objects, which some of us call tchotchkes. But these are very beautiful, very expensive tchotchkes. Basically, Judaica that's used in the home. Shabbat candlesticks, menorahs. And they had to figure out how to display them in the museum. And they chose, rather than displaying them together as a group, to intersperse them throughout the museum so that the early colonial wing of the museum, of the art there, for example, they have the Torah finials from the Turo Synagogue, as an example. And it raised interesting questions for me about how Judaica is displayed and decisions about museums, about what to do with it. And what does it mean when we take our art, our ritual pieces that are used, that we use in our homes, and we put them in this open public space? And as it turns out, I was talking to Kyla, who, as I said, just got back from New Mexico, and she had an interesting experience to add on to this one. Kyla, I'll turn it over to you.
So my husband and I were in Santa Fe for an experimental 3 weeks. It was a work, recreational sort of let's get out of Cleveland for February. And it was very successful. We got out of Cleveland for February. And we ended up doing a tremendous amount of just meandering. We like schmageggied around everywhere. We walked, and we ended up at almost every museum. And for those of you, how many of you have been to New Mexico or Santa Fe? Extraordinary public art, yes. Extraordinary private art. Extraordinary museums. So we went into a collection of three museums, which is on Museum Hill, very close together with each other, and there was only one that was open, and it was the New Mexico Museum of Folk Art and Culture. Folk art and culture. Okay, so we walked in, and there are any number of exhibits, and one of the exhibits is the sacred realm. The sacred realm, writ large, the sacred realm. the sacred realm, R-E-A-L-M. So we walk in, and we're walking through, and we see Buddhist collections, and we see Tibetan collections, and then I'm like, of course, I wander much faster than my husband, and I was like, oh my God! And he said, what? I'm like, there's a Shaviti. Like, there's, like, a Shaviti is this back here. Can we dim the lights just a little bit? Possible? So I scream out, I see this Shaviti, and a Shaviti is actually a really beautiful, I think it may be Kabbalistic in origin, but it's a beautiful calligraphied illustration which often exists on the eastern wall of synagogues, very old, and it's a meditation. It's like a, can you see it? I'll move. It's a contemplative, it's often in the shape of a candelabra. I don't know if you can really see it, but there's like these lines that go up, and then at the top is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, God's name, which is the flame. And it's this meditation, and I'm thinking to myself, I just went through Tibet, I just went through Buddha, I just went right, and all of a sudden I see this Shaviti probably from Iraq, and I'm thinking to myself, what's it doing in the New Mexico Museum of Folk Art and Culture? Is it folk art? This is a ritual piece of work. It's got God's name on it. It's, you know, it's like hand calligraphied. It's got a tremendous, it's got the Hamsa, it's got the Magen David, it's got all different kinds of stuff. It's got the zodiac in it. And I'm thinking to myself, well, this is like awesome. This is weird. This is awesome. This is really weird. And all it said next to it was, I want to make sure I get this, Shaviti Synagogue Amulet, circa 1930, Jerusalem, period. It didn't have anything else connected to it, right? So that's the first one I saw. So the second one I saw is this. And I'm like, I'm in New Mexico, ladies and gentlemen, right? The land of the Spaniards, the land of Native Americans, and this is what I'm saying. And this is a fertility pendant, and its origins are Kurdish, and it's early 20th century from Iraq. And that's all it says, is a fertility pendant. And then the next one, this was really wild. This is an amulet scroll with magical squares. Circa 1910, where? Palestine. Now the hairs on the back of my neck are standing up, and I'm thinking to myself, okay, I'm in a New Mexico museum. I'm thrilled that I'm like seeing letters and words that I recognize. And I'm also thinking, here we are, we're on sort of like this international, you know, museum community. And magical squares, how do people translate that? The one thing that I can say after all, well, and by the way, so what we saw next is I walked into the, so this is the next thing we see. We saw these masks, right, from Indonesia. And the next thing we see are instruments used in ritual life, and of course we've got the right next to the drums and everything else. So I'm thinking, okay, so we rate. How awesome is that? We're great. We rate. And on the other hand, what's the difference between cultural art and ritual objects? And how do people understand that? And it struck me as being really curious. And of course, what do I do when I'm in such a situation? I email my friend Alana, and I text her and say, you're an anthropologist. What should I do with all this stuff, right? And she's like, oh God, that's really cool. That's really, right? So here we have, in New Mexico, lots of Jewish items that people may or may not know what contextualization to put them in. What is really very interesting, and I just wanted to share this with you, is that there was a whole, it was a big poster in the front of this exhibition that said, does this exhibition present examples of aesthetic mastery, sacred images, cultural objects? The answer is going to be different for each visitor and all things at once.
So I just wanted to sort of throw that out as a response to you.
Yeah. And I think when I was speaking in Boston, these questions were so palpable in the room, because here we were at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts looking at these sacred objects. And in front of me, the audience in front of me, were all Jewish museum professionals. And of course, the question that they had was, you're taking these sacred objects not only out of the domestic space, not only out of our homes.
Homes, synagogues.
Not only out of our synagogues and putting them in museums, but now you're taking them out of Jewish museums and putting them in the public. And on the one hand is this feeling of like, we've arrived, we've made it, we're in the world. But on the other hand, this feeling of, is this in some way a violation, a stepping over the line of taking what is near and dear to us and putting it in a place where it doesn't belong, where it's not appropriate.
Oh, I also want to know what other people think when they see magic squares,
right?
And what goes through someone's mind when this is the Jewish representation that you have. And
so there was a family who was like walking.
No, but I want to know what they think. I don't want you to tell them. I just want to know what they think.
That's true. You want to know what they think, and I don't know what they think.
Yeah, yeah. And obviously, when you see it in that kind of context, suddenly the shofar, even for us, looks different.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Well, it's just another instrument there.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you, Kyla, for your Santa Fe report. So, Brian, I'm actually going to turn over the the mic to you, so to speak, the proverbial mic, to talk about Israel's recent travel ban.
Okay, so the backstory to this for myself personally is, even though I am a bit of a Jewish news junkie, I was away on vacation a couple of weeks ago, and I really unplugged. Other than like checking emergency emails for work, I was not online. I wasn't checking the news, other than some sort of like daily digest I got. And I come back a week later, and I start catching up. And one of the things I see is that on March 6th, the Knesset passed a bill. And I saw some back and forth on this in the Jewish press and even a little bit in social media. But the reason that I prefaced it that I was away is that this did not make the national news in the United States. Right? This was not being reported in the mainstream media, in the non-Jewish media, and it was only barely reported, honestly, in the Jewish media. But on March 6th, the Knesset passed legislation that states the following, quote, a visa will not be granted nor a residence permit of any kind to any person who is not an Israeli citizen or permanent resident if he or the organization or body in which he is active has knowingly issued a public call to boycott the state of Israel or pledged to take part in such a boycott. The sponsors of the bill argued that the calls to boycott Israel, so which you might know for the acronym BDS, are a new front of war against Israel. And as an explanation of understanding some of the language in the bill, using a definition from a 2011 law that made advocacy for boycotts a civil offense, the amendment applies to academic, cultural, and economic boycotts of Israel and areas under Israel's control, which includes the West Bank, right? So just so everybody understands the language of this text of the law that was passed by the Knesset says that either as an individual or as an organization, if you call for boycotts, not just of Israel as a whole, but of territories controlled by Israel, then Israel, unless you're a citizen of Israel, if you're a citizen or permanent resident of Israel, you still have right of entry, but if you are not, then Israel can deny you right of entry, even if you have an approved visa from a foreign country, or if you're coming from someplace where like the United States, where you don't usually need a visa. And Israeli human rights attorney Michael Sfard said the state could create a blacklist of anyone who signed a petition against Israel and link that list to passport numbers, which is obviously an onerous task. He also argued that the law might only target prominent activists and their supporters. So I'm curious how this plays in the United States. Is this really, something that people should be mindful of? I would say the challenge is really for people and certainly organizations that are affiliated with the so-called peace camp, quotation marks, specifically organizations like Americans for Peace Now, J Street, New Israel Fund, et cetera, which are not specifically calling for the outright boycott of Israel as a whole, the classic BDS undertaking, but entities that call for a boycott of products made in the West Bank or Gaza are also subject to this legislation. Peter Beinart wrote in the Jewish Forward, and there's a couple of pieces of this. One is he's writing an explanation of how he teaches about Israel to his children, and he writes, "I teach them to love first and then provide a full explanation, what he calls the truth, later." This is Peter Beinart. But then now he writes, "Now the Knesset wants me to choose. Either I stop visiting Israel or I stop opposing the occupation." And this raises an interesting question. First of all, what is this actually going to accomplish in terms of the goals of the bill, if we think we understand what the goals of the bill are? How should American Jews as individuals or organizations respond, if at all, to this legislation? The notion of keeping people out who are critical, even if they're sort of, you could say, whole hog BDS, right? They're in the full BDS camp. If you keep them out of your country, what does that say about your own notions of boycott, or what does that say about exposing the beauty of your country and your society to people wherever they may come from?
Can I just ask a clarification? Because I didn't read a lot about this, but one of my questions is, so those folks who are part of academic societies and universities, whose universities have taken a BDS stance, mm-hmm. but they personally haven't, but they're affiliated with that.
Correct.
They are?
Because of the language of the bill, that if you're part of an organization and how you define what it means to be part of.
So the University of Illinois' agriculture department is now boycotted because University of Illinois has taken some stance.
Theoretically.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, I think it could go that way. I think that's unlikely. I think the real target is people or groups who are aggressively against. And I think, if you really want to play it out, they're probably more concerned about Jewish Voices for Peace, for example, organizing a trip,
okay.
right? And an organized trip which has an intent to, in their mind, undermine undermine Israel's integrity and influence other people to oppose Israel.
So my question is going back to the fact that that you started with, that there was so little news mm-hmm. on it, both national news and also news even in the Jewish media.
And not in the Israeli media, though.
Not in the Israeli media. But in American, and since the article came out, I haven't really seen much other than Peter Beinart's statement. I haven't seen much about it, which leads me to wonder about the enforcement of it and whether or not it's a symbolic statement that's meant for Israelis to reinforce their sense of control over West Bank, continued sense of, West Bank is part of Israel. So is that just a symbolic statement, or do we think this is actually going to go into effect? And has it had some kind of influence on people coming to the border, coming to Ben Gurion Airport, wanting to get in and getting turned?
Well, I just know through my own personal connections that it certainly influenced people's assumptions of how easy it might be to get into the country, right? And potentially changing their plans. So, I have a relative who's very involved in an organization that claims to be a Zionist organization, but also opposes the occupation of the West Bank. And because I think his name is on the masthead of the organization, he's concerned that the next time he travels to Israel, he's going to need specific approval in advance from some government entity, which he thinks he'll likely get because he's Jewish is more outspokenly Zionist. But I think the issue is not whether it's just for some internal consumption or even broader public consumption. It's on the books, and the law passed, and that gives whoever's in charge of that mandate, if it's a foreign ministry or an interior ministry, I don't know who handles border control, they could choose to exercise it at their own discretion.
Right.
And I just think that maybe this is part of the and where it did get attention in the press is this part of a broader ultra-nationalist movement internationally that, people are concerned about shoring up their borders, just like we have the attempt here in this country, to make sure that, you know, you only let in, you know, the people who you think are safe.
So
and
you're
then safe
connecting
doesn't
it,
just mean about physical.
So you're connecting it to the immigration ban in the United States.
I mean, it did get picked up in the press just because of that.
In a small way. So I wonder what people in the audience think about whether
Who's heard about this?
So half.
Hold on, we have a mic coming around because we just want to be able to pick you up for the recording.
Yeah, we need to hear you.
We'll hear you anyway, but we want posterity to be able to hear you.
Yeah.
No. Once it goes in the mic, it's fine.
I had heard years ago about a law on our books in the States that you cannot row across Kansas. Now, it's a law that's never been put into practice. I'm just curious about laws like this from Israel so that they can pick and choose certain people that they may or may not want to come in. It's just something to say. We do this. A lot of times people do these things without really enforcing them, only to make a statement. And somehow, in reading about it, I felt that the Knesset was making a statement rather than an actual enforcement.
But you said two things. One is you said to make a statement. The other is to pick and choose. And those are two separate things. You could simply make a statement, and then you could decide how we're going to apply. And sometimes we will, and sometimes we won't.
Wouldn't we? And I think it's just something that is out there.
What gets me frustrated about this is I have a sense that this becomes one of those self-inflicted wounds because you're going to prevent the very people from coming. Now, there's maybe some people you'll never convince. You'll never sway, okay, and, you know, you don't have to, those aren't the people that I'm worried about. But, you know, the people who are open-minded, and you want to invite them in and demonstrate the language that we always hear, and I believe it's true, that Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East.
So you want to invite the democracy, invite the argument, invite the conversation.
Invite them in, have a debate if that's what's going to happen, but sort of putting up walls, even if they're not all that enforced and you're giving this impression, I don't think helps the cause of demonstrating how valuable it is to be that democracy.
I also think it's an interesting thing that when we see sort of the strength of BDS and its trajectory and its waning, that now this comes up. I think that's an interesting timing situation.
So the leader of the opposition in Israel actually said this in December, that the Likud and Netanyahu in particular is always feeding the BDS. This is his position. So it's like, act like this. And he said this in December before this act. But this sort of behavior only gives them more to work with.
Fodder.
It's fodder for them.
What stand did Illinois take?
She asked what stand Illinois took, and I was actually pulling that out of thin air because I'm a University of Illinois graduate, and I'm thinking to myself, one of the interesting things that has always been a fantastic repartee is the relationship between the University of Illinois' agricultural school, which was the Morrow Plots, was the very first school established, and Israel and its agricultural endeavors. And the University of Illinois has been wandering these lines between issues of BDS, and there's a very strong Palestinian force there. There's a very strong Iranian force there. And, you know, yay those, you know, half a century ago, I was involved in all of that. And I can only imagine. I was making it up, by the way. I have no idea, right? But that University of Illinois and Israel, who've had a very, very lovely relationship, all of a sudden, because they've got a BDS environment, would prevent professors
from... Just to clarify, the University of Illinois does not have a BDS environment.
Okay. I was using it as an example.
I know.
I just don't want anyone to get the wrong idea. Thank you.
But as a different kind of an example, you said Rabbi Megan was here last time from Oberlin.
Correct.
So she's got Jewish kids who are strong BDS advocates and outspoken leaders on her campus. And if I were one of those kids, I would assume, and now Israel doesn't want me.
Right.
And I do not think that is a good thing for our community to be facing.
Right, and even though it's unlikely, the scenario that you're describing, Joel, is these kids maybe would even get a birthright trip, and there they are at the airport checking in. They've got a birthright trip to Israel, and their name comes up. Oh, this person has been an outspoken advocate.
Ordered in the Oberlin newspaper.
Okay.
You can't come in.
Let me sort of take a different
tactic.
Yeah, no, just take a different tactic, and I'm gonna sort of repeat. Oh, sorry, what's your name?
Rita.
The way Rita posed it was perhaps the law was put in place really for a few specific individuals, and it hasn't gotten much press, and the students at Oberlin aren't gonna pay any attention. And that it's possible that there's two or three people that Israel doesn't want to let into the country because they're activist BDSers. And then I would ask the question this way. Why don't they want those people in? Are they worried about those people going to the West Bank and going into Gaza and stirring up trouble? Or are they trying to make a statement? You are boycotting us. We will not let you into the country. Is there danger of letting these people in or not?
Well,
I don't know how to answer that.
Clearly, the spokesman who said that, you know, that BDS is another war, is a front of war, mm-hmm. would say yes. Sees it as a real threat. And I would say, to sort of refute you a little bit, it's precisely those students at Oberlin who are going to pay attention to this. Mm-hmm. Right? Nobody else is paying attention to this in the news, but it's exactly those students that Joel's talking about who this is all they focus on when they read about what's going on in Israel.
In the papers, they showed that at APAC, they were marching in front of
All right, so I did want to bring it up to speed in terms of APAC. Yesterday, if you pay attention to the stuff at APAC, there is a group called If Not Now. If Not Now is a loosely organized group of millennials, primarily, who are Zionists but oppose the occupation and support boycotting the West Bank. They don't support BDS. And it's precisely that sort of organization that would probably get stuck, you know, sort of, you know, where do they fall in this conversation? And I would argue that it's precisely those people who need to be part of the conversation around boycotting and how dangerous it can be, or to demonstrate that Israel really doesn't do that and they're fighting against it.
I wanted to make a different comment. And I respect the idea. I respect the idea of having everyone as part of the conversation. What's bothering me is putting everything in the same basket. The world as a whole right now is undergoing a degree of ultra-nationalism and xenophobia. People are being grouped together because of their religion or where they come from. That's very different than putting a group together based on their own activities. Because you do take responsibility for what you do, not who you are. That's racism. That's xenophobia.
So you say it's not fair to equate this with a travel ban in the United States?
Totally. That's exactly my point. That's exactly my point. Thank you.
Well, that may be true, but I think it doesn't matter if that's what people perceive to be the case. Like I could agree with you 100% that there's a difference, but if the way that it's going to read in the news is, look, a month after Donald Trump tries to impose his travel ban, the Knesset in Israel passes its travel ban. And the nuance that you're talking about is going to get lost just because the headline is compelling. I'm not disagreeing that there's a difference.
But I would say also, you know, Israel is doing what it needs to do. And Israel, while we American Jews would like to always think that Israel should be taking into consideration whether it's going to alienate our American Jews, our young folk, our women who want to pray at the Kotel, in the end, Israel has got to figure out their policy for themselves. And if they're not trying to make a global statement, but they're trying to protect their particular interests.
Yeah, on the other hand, it's totally short-sighted of them to not assume that American Jewry would read it in a particular kind of way, right?
Well, yeah.
So like we live in this really interesting balance of...
Yeah, that's a bigger conversation about the role that not just Jews in the diaspora, but anybody else in the world,
right.
And what their attitudes might be, and to simply sort of say, well, at the end of the day, you got to do what you got to do, and let's only, you know, trust the people in the Knesset because we don't live there, which is true.
Right.
But it's also
going on over here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So why don't we take one or two more questions, and we'll move on to the next topic, Pearl.
Yeah.
Pardon me. There are people who are BDS leaders who will not go to Israel. Judy Butler is one of them. And so they express themselves the other way. We will not enter into that place. And they have an effect upon it. So, there they are. They're also saying something, and we have to be very much aware of that, and there's no way to counteract that. I don't see any problem with Israel stating who they are, and then you know where you stand, and then you know what it is you have to do, and that sometimes gets us to think about doing things in a different way. But so
the issue, and the one that Beinart raised, which I think really, you can agree with Peter Beinart or not on his broader politics, but the question is, if you, Jew or not Jew, if you are someone who opposes Israeli policy in the West Bank but supports Israel otherwise and believes in the basic tenet of Zionism that that the Jewish people need a sovereign state of their own in their ancient homeland, you just happen to think that some of the decisions made after 1967 are not necessarily in the best interest. Where do you stand then? Where do you fit in, in terms of what you're saying, Pearl? At what point does criticism of policy become so egregious and so damaging that the state, any state, feels like, well, the best way to oppose that is to boycott them? Now, Judith Butler, she believes in boycott, so she boycotts.
Right.
There's really no discussion there.
Right. She's got a big black line.
And a big mouth.
That's true. Right.
Okay.
A big pen and a big
Okay, I think we're going to move on to the next topic. Thank you, Brian. And Kyla, I'm going to turn the floor over to you. Kyla is going to speak about Jewish Cleveland tackling the challenges of Alzheimer's disease and dementia. Kyla.
In 2 minutes.
So we're here for the next 4 or 5 hours, so get really comfortable. All right, so I'm gonna tell you a little bit about this process, and then I'm gonna give you a huge disclaimer. So the process of all of this is that about 2 years ago plus, I was asked by the Jewish Federation of Cleveland to chair a committee on Alzheimer's and dementia. And it was Alzheimer's and dementia writ large, and it had a mandate that had 3 major pieces to it. And the mandate was to take a look at our Cleveland Jewish community right now, snapshot, actually 2 years ago, so we started, take a snapshot of all of the services, the personnel, the beds, the educational opportunities, the support systems provided for Alzheimer's patients and their families, and to chronicle them. What do we have? Who's doing it? How much money's involved in it? Where there's connectivity in this? Where there's coordination in this? Where there are gaps in this? Who's not doing what? Where's their duplication? So that was our first piece of work. Okay, that should have taken 2 years just in and of itself, just so you know, but okay, so that was the first piece. The second piece was to say, okay, where are there opportunities for coordination, for integration, for collaboration and cooperation within all of our assets? And the third piece of it, if that wasn't complicated enough, was to say, what is it that we're going to need 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 25 years from now, and 30 years from now, given the trajectory of our demographics? So we tried really hard to do that. And we created a report that is really thick, that's got a boatload of data collection. It would take me 2 hours to take you through the process. And the huge disclaimer is that we learned an extraordinary amount. And we learned that our community has an unbelievable number of resources, and it's rich and it's thick, and you need a PhD to navigate it. And even if you have a pocketbook the size of Montana and a Rolodex the size of Texas, you have the same problems as somebody who doesn't speak English. Okay, do you understand what I'm saying? We all are in the same boat. We're swimming in the same sea. We got the same issues, and it's really complicated, and we have a lot of stuff, and we don't know how to navigate it. Okay. The big disclaimer is that we created 44 recommendations to try to shoot through this enormous issue, and I'm not going to talk about any of those things. I am going to talk to you about three things that have risen to the top as part of the conversations, and it's three things among 27 things. And I want to throw it out there because I'm excited to get some feedback on it. Where we are right now, just so you know, is I have a full report. I have my background information and all my best practices. I have an executive summary, and I have a brochure that every single one of you can walk out with tonight that gives you a summary capsule of what we've done. And we are just at the beginning of finishing these reports and now getting it out to people. And this Tribe Talk is the first public expression of this. So
we'll be able to post a link to that.
And we have a link to it here. But I'll get a better link to it.
Okay, but they're here.
For people who are not here.
Okay. We have a link for it, and I can get people a link for the executive summary. You do not want to read the full report. make me a coffee date with me would be better. But the issue is that we've just begun to turn around to all of our stakeholders and try to explain what it is that we found. But this is the first formal public appearance of this. So here's a couple of things that I want to throw your way. There's actually three major things. So we've learned a tremendous amount. And one of the pieces of information that we used was the 2011 Greater Jewish Cleveland Population Study. Heard of it?
Yeah.
Got a phone call about it? Most of us did. So we've learned a number of things. And that is that right now, as of 4 years ago, 19% of our Cleveland Jewish population was over the age of 65, right? And at the same time, 30% of us are between 50 and 64, right? That's huge, right? That goes from 19% to 30%. We are tracking right on target with the national statistics. So within 25 years, 50% of us hold each other's hands, ladies and gentlemen. We're all going to be elderly. 50% of our population, right, is going to be over 65 and over 70. And we are, for the vast majority of us in that group right now, baby boomers. So that baby boomer goes like that. And while we've got some interesting information about the rate of Alzheimer's, we're unclear if the rate of Alzheimer's is holding steady. And what I mean by rate is I mean percentage per capita, like percentage of each population. There's some conflicting reports. There are those who say we're holding steady. There's those reports that say we're kind of going down. And there are those who say we're going up. But what's clear to us is even if we hold steady as a Jewish community, the number of people affected by Alzheimer's and dementia and their families is going to go up because our baby boomer population is going up. So that's the first thing to know, okay? The second thing to know, and this is also from the 2011 population study, is that, and this was sort of shocking because I relearned this just last week, that in 2011, 50% of baby boomers reported that the economic recession impacted them so significantly that it created an extraordinarily negative response in terms of how you are being affected economically. So if we have a baby boomer population going up, and as of 4 years ago, or 3 years ago, We have 50% of baby boomers telling us that they've been impacted in very significant ways in terms of economic hardship. What does that say? We're going to have more, and by the way, we haven't figured out yet how to assess whether or not they've recovered, right? So we've got an issue about whether or not there's been baby boomer recovery in terms of economics. But if hang on one second, I'm going to finish the three and then we'll go. So if we have a population, the largest population that we have in the Cleveland Jewish community that has been negatively impacted by economics, and they are an increasing population, one has to imagine that in 20 years, that population's capacity to pay for their own aging is going to diminish. That's number two. You ready? Hold on to your seats, right? Number three. Every demographic study that has taken place over the last 15 years has been really curious about the boomer population. We are extraordinarily unique. What are we? We want our macchiatos hot, and we want them with salt, and we want our countertops in blue and not in yellow, and we want personal trainers. And this baby boomer population has been called the customized population of the world, right? Not only do we want all of that, but we expect that we are going to live longer than everybody else, which is kind of likely, and that we're going to live well. Yeah, nobody really told us the actual facts. And if we don't live with health, that whatever fully engaged medical needs we have will be part of the package that we get, along with all of our specialists, including chiropractors. And I'm making light, but this is quantified material. Therapists, massage therapists, personal trainers, right? And psychotherapists. So here we have the convergence of really some very interesting things. We've got a huge population. We have a population that has been traumatized economically. And we have a population that wants what they want, when they want it, and how they want it. Okay? Now remember, I'm giving you this much of this study, this much. So my question to you all for conversation, and to you for then we'll open it up, is a couple of things. So given all of these things, and by the way, I want to give you one quote, and this is by Sir Terry Pratchett, who's a British author, and he writes, "The baby boomers are getting older." And by the way, I'm in that, right? I am getting older, and we're going to stay older for longer. And when we run right into the dementia firing range, how is our society going to cope with that? Especially a society that can't so readily rely on those stable family relationships that traditionally provide the backbone of care and has up until about 30 or 40 years ago, because that's no longer real. And we all know that. All of us know that. So here are my questions. So my questions are, so as this Jewish community grapples with these huge questions, and this is only really one small part of it, what responsibility does our Jewish community have in meeting my needs 25 years hence? Right? What expectations should our demographic, my demographic, your demographic, right? What kind of expectations should we have when we think about our future? No, that's true.
We're just inching in.
Come on my way. Right? What kind of expectations should we have for the future, and what expectations should we have for the role of the Jewish community? I take care of this Jewish community. I want my Jewish community to take care of me. Right? And does every person and every family who has Alzheimer's, dementia, Parkinson's deserve to live as we've grown accustomed to? No matter how much it costs or how much I'm willing to pay or can pay. And these are just some of those questions, and this is only for one part of our population. So I thought I'd share what I've been walking around with you all as a piece of this, because it's really, really interesting and extraordinarily complicated.
And so important
and
to be
extraordinarily
discussing.
Important.
Yeah, and I really want to thank you for, I know you've been doing this work, but for bringing it here and sharing it with us, because these are a lot of things that people don't talk about that much in private, and certainly at a communal level, we don't often have the opportunity to engage in, right. at this kind of, from this macro perspective, both 30 years down the road to think about that and to think on the communal perspective. So one sort of immediate reaction that I have to what you're talking about is you're posing a sort of this terrible dilemma on the one hand of a generation of customization, yeah. which means individuality, right. and the understanding that we as individuals can expect and can hope that the world will be shaped around us the way.
And that's not going to slip back in the next generation. It's only going to get worse.
Right,
as
and
you,
it
as
is
you
getting
move on.
Worse. Yeah, we see it getting worse. But you're
or
talking.
Or better. It might not be worse, could
well,
be. Better.
More extreme. Right. More yeah. extreme.
Okay.
But at the same time, you're talking about communal responsibility. So it's individuality
right.
and communal responsibility. And I don't see how those two can be combined.
In your first question, you used the word need. Like, so how is the community going to address the needs,
so needs.
The needs of the people that are going to be impacted?
Right.
And what that really raises the question is who gets to define what those needs are, and not that I wanted to spin it this way, but this is the sort of the similar conversation that you have in terms of national health care. Who gets to make right. the decision right. as to what the basic, even minimum, right, level of care, whether it's a Jewish community that's providing it or your insurance company that's providing it, who gets to make that determination? And then, you know, when we were first batting this around, there's the question of a real, you know, Jewish value of treating people in the way that they've been accustomed.
Vote, not
and
it's right.
right. And to I'll let you throw that in.
Okay.
But just I'll stick with mine for now. That listen, if someone has a certain level of expectation and they've been able to live a certain way for a long time, as long as it's within your capacity to do it, you should try. Like, as a community that's providing services.
Well, that's right? actually easy. So that's easy. But that's, guess what? That's like 1.8% of our population that gets right. to choose the way they want to live because they're able to afford it.
Right.
Okay?
Then no, but I'm not saying just the okay, money. It's but, sort of like the way.
But then there right? is the way. There is that what so you care for your parent according to Jewish law in the manner in which they've been accustomed, right? By the way, the Torah says and the Talmud says you don't have to love them, but you got to make sure that if they're used to sleeping on a mattress that's this thick, they sleep on a mattress that's this thick, not this thick. No, I'm being serious. You're laughing at me. I mean, you're laughing at me. But it's true. You don't have to love them, but according to their custom.
You have to honor.
But
you don't
what
have to love.
You have to honor. So there's this bichvod. So what's the honor piece of it? But what about children, by the way, because I'm the last of the generation that will have probably made more money than my parents? What happens when your children can't afford to take care of you in the manner to which you become accustomed? Mm-hmm. Right? So there's that whole issue. So then there's the 98%+ of us that will fall into the category of being taken care of by Medicare, Medicaid, Jewish community, philanthropy dollars, and out-of-pocket expenses. Therein lies the rub, right?
You do what you can.
Well, but the question is like, do you do what you can, or do you set a value, right, that says, you know, a certain not just level of medical care, but some sort of a type of environment has additional value, you know, and I'm sure this is something, you know, that Joel, you're struggling with professionally. You know, if people...
it's a flow.
You know, and if people, especially if they really can't take care of themselves on a day-to-day basis, but want to still age in place, at home, what, you know, who makes that decision?
And by the way, we're also not just talking about the care for the individual. So let's be clear about that too, because we're talking about care for folks who have dementia and support for the rest of their family systems, right? Which is actually sometimes even more critical, right? And so when we project this out, Rabbi Nosenchuk, we interviewed hundreds of people, policemen, you can't even imagine who I met with, but I met with all the rabbis. You should forgive me. I don't want to meet with any more rabbis anymore. But I met with all the rabbis. But Nosenchuk said something very interesting. He said, I think that the thing that is going to capitalize and solidify this community in the next 25 years is going to be not Israel, not our kids, not Jewish education. No, caregivers. We are all going to become caregivers. And what it means to be a caregiver is really complicated. And we met with people who quit their jobs in order to care for people. We met people who actually didn't buy groceries so that they could buy their parent groceries. Like, really. And this is not the most peripheral of the community. This is sort of quasi-mainstream community. So it's really complicated.
But doesn't your whole introduction about baby boomers actually, that's actually challenged this also.
Yes.
Because the model you raised earlier of the 30, 40 years ago where the families were still more nuclear and it was understood.
Yes.
That you care for the elderly yes. was just part of the deal. Mm-hmm. The whole personalization, and you could argue there's a level of narcissism involved in it, which is sort of certainly trickled down further generationally. Part of that is, I shouldn't have to do that, right?
Exactly.
So Rabbi Nosenchuk might think that's where we're going to go. I don't see that in terms of the broader intellectual trends.
But you can actually, it's a question of how you define caregivers. And by the way, the United States government considers caregivers to be anybody who gives up more than 2 or 3 hours a month okay. or any financial support, Fair. Any financial support. So you could be out of state and paying somebody's rent and be considered a caregiver, right? Right. Versus somebody who's really in the home taking care of somebody.
But you're saying that basically the because of the nuclear family kind of disbanding.
And the self-centered burden, culture.
Yes, that yes. the burden is going to fall so much more so on the community.
On the community. So that is still caregivers, but Correct. You know, have we set ourselves up
okay,
over the last 50 years of pulling people away from that
Okay,
work.
let's open it
so
up.
So the first thing I want to say, though, is on the community or on the government? And so where is this all going when we put healthcare into?
Right, and you know what the truth is that I had 2 years and I could only handle the Jewish Cleveland community and that
right.
was like enough. But when you talk about the whole medical system and the whole insurance system and the whole legal system, it's mind-boggling.
And I'm the epitome. I just want to say that I am definitely, and you are too, I know, in this generation where we are dealing with this. I was taking care of my mother, I was taking care of my children, and my son, what he says to me is, is he Generation X considered? He's saying to me, Mom, I already picked out nursing homes, it's fine. So just so that you know, it's true.
Kyla, I cannot tell you how much I appreciate you. The people that must hear this, are our kids, our grown children. Because when I grew up, we took care of our parents. I mean, we never, quote unquote, put them away. My children fight over me. Mom, Jill will take you. No, I'll take you. No, I don't want to take you. He'll take you. My point is that they told me, sign up for a place, Mom, because if you don't, we're going to put you where we want you, and you're not going to be happy. Now, what I'm saying is those kids have to be educated. They don't realize that 30, 40 years ago, we had a responsibility to our parents. We didn't shove them out, whether they had dementia, whatever they had. I'm not going to go into all that. And it's a whole different world now. So this has to be looked into. And yes, the responsibility of the Jewish community, thank God, has been wonderful.
Well, while the microphone is passing, people are also living a lot longer. So what might have been
That's
like
right.
a
That's
prospect
right.
of a 5-10 year deal could be a 30-year right. caregiving
right.
deal.
Right.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Oh, good. Go ahead. Thank you.
What you're bringing up, all those social issues are critically important. I just have one question. In your research, Kyla, has there been any data on the amount of research dollars and education being spent on looking for a cure for dementia. And I've been involved with this, and not at all. Cancer, the progress that's been made in cancer has been incredible. Everything you see is about cancer and dollars going into cancer. I hardly see any funds really going into dementia. I think that's going to be society's next big problem.
So what Rick asked about was about money and funding and focus in on research and dollars towards research towards a cure. And the truth is that I want to say yes and yes and unfortunately no in some respects. It's an interesting conundrum that we're in as a Jewish community, because one of the things that we try to figure out is what are we good at, right? What is the Jewish community good at? And one of the things that we're not good at is raising international and national dollars for research. But we are really good at being conveners and collaborators and partners. And there are any number of organizations that are out there that are doing tremendous amounts of work in terms of legislation and research dollars and so on and so forth. Right. So we are actually beginning to really put some effort towards partnering with those folks who are seemingly doing the most that they can be doing. We've reconnected with our folks in Ohio, in Columbus, and on the national level. So JFNA, you know, the Jewish National Federated Communities, has a presence on the Hill. So Alzheimer's was not on their agenda. Now it is, okay? Now it is. But caregiving was, but caregiving for older individuals with brain injury and, you know, that kind of thing. So it's an interesting process in terms of what's being pushed forward. The other thing is, one of the dilemmas that we're in as a Jewish community is, what do we do for our folks on the ground? What do we do for our folks on the ground in 10 years? What do we do for our folks on the ground in 30 years and our agencies, by the way? And if you think that engaging with our agencies has been, you know, sort of a sweet little travel down a brook, it hasn't been, but it's been extraordinarily productive. And I think that one of the most interesting things that has come out of this is that the landscape of collaboration and conversation between agencies, and I'm going to call them out, JFSA and Montefiore and Menorah Park and the JCC are talking about real things now that have to do with care on the ground. But what we're not able to do, Rick, is like, we're not in a position of raising money, you know, to dump towards research.
No, I'm not asking that. I'm asking, is there an infrastructure nationally, whether it's a Jewish community or not?
Right now, the Alzheimer's Association is the biggest one.
Parkinson's.
Well, Parkinson's, but that's dealing with Parkinson's, and that's not dealing with dementia writ large. It's not dealing with dementia, right? But it's a piece
okay.
Of
let's get two or so more comments, reactions from the audience.
Keep it short if you can.
Yeah, let's just keep it moving.
It's different too, as our children's generation moves all over the country, and we don't have them here to call in and take care of us. I deal with a lot of disabled people. My Jewish clients say, where will we put our parents? My Gentile clients have their parents moving in with them, and they're taking care of multi-generations right in their own homes. It's common to have many generations. The Jewish people are saying, we'll put them somewhere. The Amish, as their culture, all take care of each other. I heard a Muslim speak today who said, you have to look at yourself and say, what am I going to do? I think, Kyla, that's what you were saying today. We have to say, what are we going to do as dementia is getting more prevalent and it's going to keep growing? You're dealing with the agencies who are just beginning to wake up and say, what are we going to do? This is a major crisis we're facing, and we have to look at it differently. And I think, thank you for opening our eyes to that.
When you mentioned about the children making less than their parents, which is absolutely true. When my mother used her money and then my brother and I were using ours, that was one thing. Our kids can't do that. They don't have that kind of money. And they think that magically things will, their parents will get taken care of. But you can't look to agencies to just be able to take care of their parents. And I think this is a very broad, concerning picture.
Yeah, both of these questions, I think, bring up macro structural changes that are happening at the same time that we're facing this aging crisis. Yeah.
I can really only talk about now. I volunteer at Montefiore. I've been volunteering for 16 years, and I have seen the ebb and flow. And I, what I recognize is that now we are using people from the poorer community, from the communities that Jews have kind of backed away, and now we have to use the people in the inner city to come in, the young black people that are coming in to take care of our children, our parents, and the older people. And somehow in the Jewish community, we don't seem to have a connection and realize that these are the people that maybe in 10 years you're going to have to associate with. You can't just associate with just Jewish people. We have to understand and broaden our perspective that we have to understand to use other people in the community. They will be the ones who will take care of us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thank
can
you.
I have the last word on this?
Yeah. Yeah, okay, Kyla, I'm going to give you one last word, and then we're going to move for about 10 minutes to our last topic.
So I think that one of the things that I've been doing is meeting with a lot of our stakeholders. I met with the Montefiore board last week. I'm going to meet with Menorah Park. I've been meeting with all the executives, presidents, and we're trying to figure out how to get responses to not just our recommendations, but to these kind of critical issues. Because if I tell you this is one of the critical issues of like 22 critical issues that we've, like one of the other issues has to do with affordable housing. We can't even walk there right now, right? So all of this stuff is really palpable, but somebody turned around at a meeting last week and said, you know what this needs? This needs a sea change. Our perspective of this needs to be a sea change. We've got to stop talking about it in the same kind of way. And I thought to myself, well, what does that mean, right? What does that mean? And it means actually an interesting thing about what does it mean to stop the trends that we are engaged in, right? And begin to reconfigure and re-educate. And I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means for me when I educate my children, right? Or what does it mean for when Eileen says to me, you know, we gotta tell my kids. Well, your kids are 45 and 50 and 55 years old. And what are we gonna retrain your 55-year-olds to think differently about their lives and your life? And you know what? That's really a critical issue. And I'm not so sure what a sea change means, but my sense is that We've got to capture it differently somehow. And these kinds of conversations, so if it bubbles out and all of a sudden you walk outside and over the course of the week you start talking to people and saying, look, we've got this really interesting thing happening here, then the nature of the dialogue is gonna change. And I gotta tell you something, my estate planning is different right now than it was 4 years ago before I started this. The way I'm talking to my kids is different. Right? My living will is articulated. And so there's peace, and I'm 56 years old, right? And my mother has been suffering from Alzheimer's for 18 years, and my grandmother died of Alzheimer's. And the truth of the matter is, with regard to preclinical Alzheimer's, if I have it, you're looking at me right now having it, right? It's right? It's a whole other conversation. So what that means for us is huge, and the dialogue has to be different, and
it's a whole other conversation, which we should have sometime.
Yeah, in fact, I feel a little bit funny about this,
I'm
but
sorry.
Our next conversation is about cemetery desecration.
Here we go.
See, you gotta laugh. See, that's good.
Listen, a little humor.
You gotta laugh.
So I wanted to bring up the topic of, we'll end at 8:30, so I know some people have to go, but if you're able to stay for the next 15 minutes or so. I thought about speaking about cemetery desecration because over the past month and a half or so, many of you might have followed in the news, several reports of Jewish cemeteries came out of vandalism. The cemeteries that were listed in the news as vandalized was one in Rochester with just about 5 headstones that they found overturned, one in Philadelphia where there was between 75 and 100 headstones overturned, and one in St. Louis where they found about 150 headstones overturned. And one in Brooklyn, and this is the one that I want to focus on because the news came out that a cemetery in Brooklyn had been vandalized, and within about 24 hours, the news had to shift because it turned out after further investigation, in fact, there had been no vandalism at all, and the headstones that they thought had been intentionally turned over were simply in a state of disarray because of erosion and because of lack of maintenance in the cemeteries themselves. And one of the journalists commented on this discovery by saying there was a collective sigh of relief and shrug, and the news cycle moved on. And this particular journalist was saying, her comment was, why were we so distressed and up in arms about the cemeteries being desecrated when in fact many of our cemeteries are not being properly maintained, and we have to do a lot of inward looking? And for me, this really caught my eye and made me think about a connection to what had happened with the bomb threats with the JCCs of late. I'm sure many of you know, most of you know, that approximately 150 JCCs and a few schools had received bomb threats over the past, the same period that the cemetery's desecration was happening and getting news, was the bomb threats to the Jewish community centers. And just a few days ago, we learned that, in fact, the bomb threats were not coming from any anti-Semitism from the outside, neither from the right nor from the left, but from some strange, deranged, perhaps mentally ill, a Jewish Israeli young man from Israel who the FBI helped track down and found him there in Israel. And through this whole thing, a few questions came up in my mind in thinking about this sort of link. And the first one is just how afraid should we be? I know that there's a lot of conversation with many of my friends in my circles about the fact that we need to be very, very scared about the rise in anti-Semitism now on the one hand, and people are, you know, like wondering at what point do we pack our bags and leave? And on the other hand, other people saying there's an overreaction, the press is like pumping things up. And this is related to another question, which is the politicization of anti-Semitic claims. And the question about how claims of anti-Semitism are sort of feeding into people's worries about the current political climate. And a really wonderful example about that Brooklyn cemetery that that journalist gave was she said that 6 years ago there was vandalism in that same cemetery, the Brooklyn cemetery, where it turned out there was no vandalism now. 6 years ago, 200 stones were toppled through a clear act of vandalism, and it did not make national news. And so why is it making the national news now? And the final question that I have, which is maybe the simpler, like less confusing one of all of them, but I've been thinking about a lot recently, and I'll ask the two of you, how much security do we need? And by that, I'm asking security for our JCCs, because my understanding right now is that there's very highly increased protocol around security for our JCC here today. And I'm wondering if that is appropriate and if it should be in place. And then the question about security for our cemeteries as well, because now there's increased not only awareness, but there is the community is coming together to talk about security cameras, about lighting, about making sure that the cemeteries are maintained, not just for the sake of maintaining the cemeteries, but for the sake of making sure that it doesn't seem like an inviting place for people to come hang out.
It's like,
and
like a neighborhood that's all boarded up,
yes,
and right, seemingly invites it.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So what do you think?
So it's actually very funny that you raised the very last question, because as I walked in, I thought to myself, there's no security guard here. I wonder what's going on. like Siegal Lifelong Learning doesn't need the same kind of, like, you know, right, strategy, security strategy that the rest of our Jewish communal services need. And actually, I went right back to Shabbat morning, right? You were, right? Pauline was there. So we have a security guard that used to be in the very front of our shul, and now the security guard is in the sanctuary. And during the sermon, our rabbi called him out and invited him to give him some feedback on his sermon because he was talking about security issues, right? And it was actually very cute and very funny. But so we've not just invited this issue of, like, being vigilant, like, with regard to the outside of our places, but we've actually invited our vigilance inside of our sanctuaries, right? So to what extent does this go? And by the way, why aren't we being covered? I just wanted to know.
What do you mean, why aren't we being covered?
Well, there's no security.
Because we're not worried.
Oh, we are not?
This is a Case Western Reserve University adult education program.
Oh, it's a Case Western Reserve. Got it, okay.
And we don't view ourselves as a prime target.
Has there been a discussion about it?
When we first moved here, we had a brief discussion about it.
Okay, I'm just curious. Okay.
Separate conversation.
Okay.
But, I mean, I'm going to repeat something I said last month, which is when I see more security at our Jewish institutions, I feel less safe. I feel less safe. It doesn't make me feel good. It doesn't make me feel any more secure. You know, and, you know, granted, we've been very fortunate in this country, and to some extent, we're fortunate that this was all a hoax. Is it that we're fortunate that it was a hoax, or does it make perfect sense that it was a hoax, because that generally doesn't happen in this country? Right, I'm just throwing that out there. We do not have a history of regular violent assault. I'm not talking about swastikas being spray painted somewhere. We do not have a history of regular violent assault on Jewish institutions in this country the way that it is the case in other parts of the world. And I think that's good. All right, I don't think it's necessarily that we've been lucky. I think that the environment of the United States, notwithstanding, I think you're right that a lot of stuff has been politicized lately. So notwithstanding people trying to pull in different directions, America has played out differently. That may change.
But
like, I have no guarantee for the future.
Are you suggesting that the security itself might invite potential harm?
Listen, the problem is it's a no-win situation, right? Because who in their right mind is going to be the one to say, you know what, I got a great idea that'll save us a few bucks. Let's cut back on the security and be the one who cuts back on security and then, God forbid, something happens, right? So there is no going back, right? And I don't think there's, you know, you could maybe bring your threat level down. That happens. But there's sort of no going back as you raise the norm, and the European model validates that, right? Every time you go to the next level, first it's just a guard, then it's a guard with a visible sidearm, then it's a guard with a submachine gun. Yeah. But once you've made that step,
That's the direction you're going.
Don't go back. So even though my personal belief is that we're still in a pretty good place in the United States, in terms of a general level of safety for the Jewish institutions and Jewish population in America, once you move in that direction, I don't think you can move back.
No. Okay, let's take a few comments, and then we'll wrap up.
Many of us feel...
Wait 1 minute.
I'm sorry. Many of us remember the times when we used to walk into our schools or walk into our JCCs, and nothing was locked up, and I think that you're right on this with this, is that we took more action ourselves to watch out for each other. Now, granted, we can't, the society has changed, but it's just very much sad that, you know, our children have never been able to just walk into a building, a Jewish building. It's always been with a guard or with a lock or with a...
Well, one of the questions I have, Leslie, about that is this just a Jewish thing, or is that an indicator of sort of the broader sense of hypervigilance and overprotective parenting?
No, it is hyper...
I'm not talking about airports. I'm talking about my kids going to the playground, right? The notion that your kids could walk to school. How many kids do you see walking to school anymore. It's not just the Jewish kids.
Or,
right?
Or the cell phones that we all have because, you know, you have to contact them every 20
minutes,
right?
Yeah, I mean, there's all sorts of reasons why we have cell phones. But even with the cell phones, right, when you can contact them and track them, you're still not letting your kids wander the streets and play in the park and just go into the institutions. Right, walk into school. So that's not just, I'm wondering how much of that is, yes, because we've had the threats on the Jewish institutions, of course, that makes us more sensitive. But more broadly, as a society, and there's really very little data to back up the need, right, that things have gotten so much worse in terms of public violence on the streets of suburban Midwestern cities in America. But nevertheless, that's what we've done.
Yeah, a couple of comments about the cemetery situation and also about the threats from, you called him a deranged individual. I'd like to reason by analogy. You know, the First World War was started by the assassination of the Archduke Ferdinand. Everyone said, well, who was the assassin? Why did he shoot? It's not the right question. The question is, who paid for the bullet? Okay, this kid didn't come up with this idea by himself. The operation and logistics are too far ranging for a teenager to pull off on his own. And I don't believe for a minute that he was in it by himself. Second thing is that acts of vandalism against Jewish cemeteries historically have been acts of terror. They've been designed to destabilize the Jewish community, to make them feel unsafe, to make them feel insecure, and to send them a message to stay in their place. It's no different than lynchings of black people in the South. They're acts of terror. And the third thing is with regard to security at our institutions. Within recent memory, we've had two federations that have been involved active shooters, one in Seattle, the other in Kansas, where there were deaths. And horribly and paradoxically, in Kansas, the people who died weren't even Jewish.
Now, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but, you know, if you compare the size of the American Jewish population and the number of our institutions, the number of acts, which do happen and they're horrible, but compare that to the European models with their smaller populations, smaller number of institutions where that is actually a regular occurrence, I just think we've been fortunate to be in a different place for a long, long time.
As a matter of scale, I think. Yeah.
Just a quick question. Would we feel safer if we went to the airport without TSA there? Or would we feel more safe? What's our reaction?
Do what's your reaction?
Well, is it making us feel safer or less safe?
No, I'm asking, does it make you feel more safe or less safe?
Personally?
Yeah.
Me personally?
Yeah, you personally.
I don't think it makes a difference.
Okay.
Okay. Do you have a question? Comment? We'll give you the final word.
Rochelle, you got the final word.
I'm just saying.
I'll get the final word. I'll give you the final question.
Some of the security is just so strange. I mean, you go to the Indians game, and then a man will or a woman will just look in your purse and go, oh, okay, you're fine. I mean, it's gotten... No, or you go to the Cedar and Lee, and someone will look in your purse and go, okay, you're fine. I mean, how do they know what you have in your purse? And then another thing is, the cemeteries in Cleveland are a Shonda, most of them. My girlfriend, thank goodness, was very upset about some of the cemeteries and finally got the Federation to help support fixing them up, because the ones on the west side were just horrible.
Yeah,
so I wanted to ask you, this will give you the last word, because I think this is a great point, broader issues of what happens when a community relocates far away from its cemeteries or any other institution. I know that you look at this in the European setting.
Yeah, I mean, and I think it's a question that's related to the mobility also. I mean, it's related to bigger macro issues. You're saying that these cemeteries on the west side are, you know, like falling apart. Cleveland's Jewish community has moved.
People still go there.
Yes.
And, you know, their families.
But whose responsibility is it, Rochelle? And when communities move and when there's mobility, right? I'm not arguing.
They have a caretaker there.
But it's a bigger question of funding. It's like, how responsible, like what happens? You've got this whole notion of what happens when communities in certain areas die out, and what happens to their synagogues, and what happens to their cemeteries, and what happens to their tourist girls and what happens to all their stuff, right?
Goes to the museum. The museums, there's, yeah, more and more and more museums.
Right.
Okay, folks, we are going to end with the question that I always end with, which is, what Jewish culture are you consuming? I will ask my panelists. Brian, what Jewish culture are you consuming?
Okay, so this is actually an excerpt from a broader piece, but if this is something everyone can read quickly, because the headline is, you really need to read this terrific interview. So this is from the Forward with George Steiner, but it's an excerpt from a larger book. So you can go online and look for, you really need to read this terrific interview with George Steiner, who is an intellectual, a self-proclaimed both anti-Zionist and lover of Israel, so it's very interesting, interesting guy. And the other one I want to share, which I haven't started yet, but I'm very excited to, is the new Amos Oz novel, which has been translated into English, titled Judas.
Oh. So,
Judas. J-U-D-A-S. Yeah.
And I'll share, I am teaching a class on the Jewish holidays, and I struggle finding textbooks to give to my students, because most of the books that sort of track the holidays or the Jewish calendar are dogmatic. They tell you how you should practice or what practice ought to look like. And I found this wonderful book that came out about 4 or 5 years ago by Judith Shulevitz, who's a philosopher. And it's called The Sabbath World. And she gives an outline of the history of the Sabbath and the rabbinic sort of laws that have evolved over time. But it's a personal narrative as well about her own struggle to live in the contemporary modern Jewish world and to deal with questions about religion and how does she be both in the modern world and incorporate religious practice as well. And so she has her own sort of personal narrative in it, which I think allows a very interesting way in to give many different stories about how the Sabbath isn't observed and how it helps us to mark time. It's called The Sabbath World.
And it's great. And she talks about the notion of time both as an old soul and as a new soul.
Yes.
And I love that book too.
Okay, and Kyla, what Jewish culture are you consuming?
So for those of you who know me, which are many of you in this room, you know that I have very, very divergent interests. So my engagement right now in Jewish social media and literature is within the range of the transgender conversation within the Jewish community. So I'm reading a book called Balancing on the Mechitza. Literally, thinking about it, you know, the balance beam between the Mechitza. Balancing on the Mechitza, transgender in the Jewish community. And I'm reading a blog called The Second Transition, which is the struggles of a transgender woman who was born as a male, assigned as a male, in a Hasidic ultra-Orthodox home, whose first transition was leaving that Hasidic world, and her second transition was into femaleness. And the complicated and overlapping metaphors that this person uses with regard to what it means to leave a community and engage in a new community and become a different identity, even though she felt like she was always born a particular identity. And so for those of you who know, I'm teaching a class in transgender and gender issues and identity issues. This is kind of the work that I'm doing, along with Alzheimer's stuff, just so you know, like, you know. So that's what my read is.
Okay, please join us next month on May 22nd for our next Tribe Talk.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, everyone.